to wave your hands to Jesus and say, Father, I love you. I love you this morning because your mercy endures forever. Your grace is sufficient. His mercy is ever new in our life. Just raise your voice and begin to worship Him. And tell Him, your grace is sufficient, oh God. You always forgive me when I ask for forgiveness. You always heal me when I ask for you to heal me. My healer you are.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Oh yes. Makana kajeso. Hallelujah. 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 I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Your grace is sufficient, Lord. Your grace is sufficient, Lord. Yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, your grace and your love endures forever. Father, your grace. Wave your hands to Jesus. We worship you. We say, Father, your grace, your grace. Yes.
Hallelujah. We worship you. Yeah. We worship you.
Come on, sing with me and say, yeah.
We worship you.
We've come to worship you, Lord.
We worship you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Father, it's a great morning. It's a wonderful day. We avail ourselves to you as an offering for worship. We are in this spiritual school, Lord, to understand about the Holy Ghost. His true purpose in our lives, that we may be converted into true worshipers of God. We want to be distinct in as much as we want to be your people. It is that attitude we bring into the church, into your church this morning. We are so grateful your presence here, Father. We are so grateful that through what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary, he earned us fellowship with you. We are not going to take for granted the effort we saw you taking and the effort we saw Christ Jesus taking. In the same vein, the effort we see the Holy Spirit taking. As he points to Christ, as he points to you, as he, you know, reminds us about who we are. Yes, as he tells us that we ought to rise to the truth until we are there standing, true worshipers. I thank you, my God. I bless you, my Father. For always thou art grace, thou art great in all things, I pray. Amen. May you be seated. God bless you. I don't know how the Holy Spirit was conveyed this morning, the way the Holy Spirit was being taught you this morning. I am witnessed in my spirit that it did much to so many people. It did much. Much to so many people. I would like us nowadays, really, I am being compelled in my spirit to make a very crucial reminder that you worship God with the knowledge of who he is, and with the knowledge of his expectation in worship. When you do that, you cease to be an ordinary man. What may make you ordinary, even though you are a Christian, is in your lack of understanding about who God is and your lack of understanding and a belief about his expectation upon your life. If you lack that, you are almost a non-Christian. You are almost at equal par with the non-believers, even though you observe programs in church. Observation of programs in church without adhering to his expectations is a sheer wastage of time. It can be very disappointing that you spent, the rest of your life remaining operating around God without God's understanding, clean understanding. I want to assure you, really, when you operate, when you work with God, that He is a God of precisions. He works according to specificity. He doesn't do things which are almost. He does the exact thing, and He expects the exact thing. Please don't be left behind this sermon. It shall be very good for you. You see, the reason why you are groping around, wondering exactly what to do at some point when you are challenged spiritually, it is in your lack of positioning with regards to the understanding of God's expectation upon your life. Full stop. You see, I am told in the Word of God that when you use a blunt axe, you apply too excessive energy than is called for. I am reminded this morning that a good number and many of us are applying excessive energy on spiritual matters as if it was by their effort things must happen. Yet, indeed, accordingly, it is in their lack of positioning with regards to God, who God is, with regards to His expectations. When you grasp these, you are at home, even amidst a very strong turbulent. You're at home. You see, I think I am reminded to bring you this scenario inside where Paul is in a very troubled environment. There was a heavy storm, and others are helter skelter. They are in great confusion. They are fearful for their lives. But look at this man who is spirit-filled. He says, "Man, listen to me. Stop striking panic buttons. None of you will die." It reminds me that God does not want us not to know when we are dying. You see, that's why people like David would pray, "Lord, teach us to number our days, that we may know how to apply our hearts to wisdom." You see, you are not expected to operate in church in ignorance. Ignorance is a terrible thing. I think I reminded some of you that with ignorance, not even God can deliver you. That's why he had to make a clean confession that, my people die due to lack of knowledge. They die while he's there watching them, just like that. Because he can't deliver you from ignorance. And you see, when you become knowledgeable, you become dangerous to the devil. You won't strike panic buttons. The Bible says they will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. When you are free, you are free, even you are free against the devil. You can move in the direction of the devil. You won't avoid him. You are free. Because you are free, he is the one to give you the way, to give you precedence. they will know the truth. And the truth will set them free. But this generation wants to be set free outside the truth. You see, that's why they can run around trying to listen to as many people as is possible without necessarily having to listen to God Himself. They will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. You cannot be set free by the truth you have no knowledge of. You cannot be set free by, you know, you cannot be set free by men. No wonder the Bible says, cursed be a man who puts his trust in another man, believing that the other man can free me. God was compelling you to move in the direction of the truth all the time, and not necessarily in the direction of men. They will know the truth. And the truth they have known will free them. You see, you may know a very eloquent nganga, but he is so limited. It's unfortunate you don't know even who is limited and who is free. The only person who is described as free is a person who has been liberated by the truth he has come to know. If you have truth, a lot of truth, which you have no revelation about, then you are in a big trouble, as much trouble as someone who does not even know the truth. That's why the scriptures say, although they knew God, they did not worship Him as God, which implies that God is a God of precision. Full stop. You meet God at His precision. You know, no casual behavior around God. Otherwise, you are merely wasting time. When it comes to God, it's a serious matter. You just want to know what is expected of you. You just want to know who God is and what He expects, and therefore draw from that what is expected of you. Then you are rich. When you are like that, you are now a child of God. You are no longer one that can be moved by any wind of doctrine, because you are not available to men. You are available to the truth that will set you free. You have to identify with what sets you free. You may identify with a very big church which seems glamorously doing well, but you remain very small and very vulnerable to attacks of the devil, even in the big church. So don't move by sight. Move by the Spirit of God. Don't move by might. Move by the Spirit of God, not by power, not by might, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Then I said, God is a God of precision. If you come to understand that, you can convert yourself into a true Christian and a true worshiper. You see, when you know the truth, God will reprove you in line with that truth and perfect you in the process. The Holy Spirit is for a people who have known the truth. Because the Holy Spirit will teach you about the truth. The Bible says He will show you the truth, because His intention is to have you totally free. Ah, One can almost literally say, it is not the Holy Spirit who sets you free. He will lead you to the truth. The Bible says he will guide you to the truth. And the truth will set you free. So don't be too religious and say, now, you know, I have the Holy Spirit. I'm now free. I'm spirit-filled. I'm now very free. No, no, no. How much of the truth which must set you free is in you? The Holy Spirit is only meant to vehicle you to the truth. And they watch you being freed. That's why Jesus says, you know, he will talk to you about me. So truth is the barometer. Else you can mistake all people who are gathered under the tree, who are bubbling with conflict. And you say, yay, these guys are free. They are making strong, powerful noise, powerful spiritual noise. How do you know it's spiritual? And how do you know which spirit? except where the spirit leads you to the truth. Marasha Kamo. That's when you say, this is the spirit of God. Because it is leading me to the truth. Because it is talking about Jesus. You see? Now when the Spirit comes and says, we don't use the Bible because the Bible is mere yester food. A total ostracization of the truth. And then you go there for help, for freedom. Don't assume such dangerous ignorance. Even under greatest compulsion of fear and pain, you must never be directed by your pain where to worship, but by the truth. By the truth. Because we have Christians who come very seriously to church, but under compulsion of attacks from the devil, when they are under serious temptations, they can go to whoever they are told is doing it. Without even, you know, spiritual issues have precisions. You don't just, you know, ask any man to lay you hands from which spirit. I can see people are getting blessed here. Can you pray for me? Can you, you know, you are in stupid ignorance, which can even cost you your life. Don't be so sightseeing, if ever there is such English. Don't be so sightseeing, trying to see. I think it's my English I'm manufacturing here. Let me not be too vociferous about it. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't go around sighting around as if you are an expert. Sit down nicely, carefully, and they will teach you how to go about it. It took us years, decades, for us to speak eloquently about this faith. It took us decades. You see, I'm completing my third decade looking at spiritual things on daily basis. For me to gather this degree of eloquence in the scriptures, in the understanding of the word, and how one must bless themselves spiritually. You see, you don't go anywhere to anybody for something spiritual. That is very dangerous. Otherwise, instead of blessings coming and overtaking you, curses will come and overtake you. We have people who are being overtaken by curses. So they can, even Christians, because they are not yet founded upon the doctrine that frees them they will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. If you were to read quickly in the book of Genesis chapter 7 verse 5, you are going to hear that the Bible saying, and Noah did according to all that the Lord commanded. And Noah did everything according, everything. Listen to me. There is this thing I said, resistance to the reproof of conscience. When the Holy Spirit arouses your conscience towards the truth, and you continue to gravitate towards lies. You continue to speak like somebody who does not quite understand what you are doing, and what to be knowledgeable about. You see, I have to get you to this scripture again. Although they knew God, they didn't worship Him as God. God, like I said in my introduction, can only be worshipped in spiritual precision when you adhere, when you comply with the scriptures. That is where you gather victory. When you are praying and praying hard, it is in your evoking of scriptures, evoking scriptures in the prayer, evoking the truth. The devil, what the devil fears is not a prayer warrior, but a truthful warrior. Are you with me? You may go for all night prayers, but please, if you have no scripture to quote, go back and sleep. You are wasting resting time. In actual fact, you are training yourself to be too religious and to be too argumentative in the religion you are developing in yourself. Because you are hardening your heart by going through the whole night parroting your words and asking God to have mercy on you without a scripture of that mercy. Some go to the extent of crying laboriously, "Hey, hear me now. I am in the night. I am sacrificed. Don't sacrifice. Go and sleep." Please. We want to save you energy. Don't operate in ignorance. You are wasting time. You are not gaining ground in any way. Neither are you appreciating any value at all. Otherwise, the opposite is happening. You are depreciating any value in the sight of God. Hey, hey, look at others. Hey, I'm behind. So who must put you at the fore? When you don't have the truth. I'm amused by this song which came into my mind when I talked of the behind and the fore. You see, Kwanzi, Ngova Zose Nini Okusaira Sei Mambo. You see, to those that don't, you are never at the fore. You know, why are you? You must ask yourself, why are you at the back? Because those that are with the Holy Spirit, the truth blesses them at the fore. You shall always be heads and not tails. That's what the Holy Spirit is saying. But when you are always at the back, there is this pathetic song you always must sing. Even when you acknowledge your positioning, it won't change anything. It's a mere melancholous cry in the sight of God, which will never change your status. Unless you identify with the truth. Because only the truth will set you free. Only the truth. You see. Ah, don't pray to God like that. Because he has given you the truth. So that you can never be at the back. With a prophecy attached to the truth. Thou shalt be head and not tail. With this truth. Why is it that you have the truth and you are ever at the rear? You are a rear wheel. Fixed at the back. All the time. The artist said all the time. Because it will be all the time unless the truth comes there. Listen to me. There was this person who was by the river. And when Jesus Christ came, this was the day of the truth in his life. And he says, Lord, before I can jump into the pool, I find quite a number already in. And all the time I am at the back. But here is the day of the truth. You will never be at the back. Listen to the truth. Have a revelation. You see. So he was persuading Jesus to remain there until the angel comes. He was addressing life away. He was addressing the truth away so that the truth does not operate as the truth. He wanted Jesus to remain there because he realized that at least I like this, because he realized that Jesus had some mercy. He was a man of compassion. He says, this man, if I ask him, he can sit there for me. Even for years, he may sit there. Because he was 38, tired and tedious, yes. Around the pool. And the things were happening with speed. He could not cope with. Fuku, 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 fuku. He's at the bank already. So don't come to church to listen to other people's testimonies of victory. What is keeping you at the back? Discover. Jesus had to help him, this person, have a revelation of who he was. Are you understanding? Revelation of the truth is very important. Even if you have the truth and a lack revelation of it, you will still die. Because this man was asking for the impossible. He was asking Jesus to operate outside the assignment he had come to do. To talk there with this man for the other coming 10 or so years. That Jesus was going to be fast moving into the water in order to have this man come first and be delivered. Noah did everything according to what God had commanded. That is why the ark was functional and could save life, because it had been made according to the truth about God. It's not because it was made with the wood that can float. God can make even anything float. That's why the Holy Spirit had to make that eggs float on the water. That's why he walked on the water. He defied the laws of gravity. It's not about the gopher tree. It's about the truth. Amen. Are you getting what I'm saying? It was made according to the shape, according to the millimeters and the half millimeter required by God for the Holy Spirit to fit in. Specificity. Underplay. This is what a believer is called upon to observe details. You see, I know of people on the road who have problems observing detail. They drive and the policeman stops. Okay, what speed are you going, my friend? 150. Did you read that sign? Detail. The detail that is telling you the truth about that area of the road. I mean, if we on earth are that particular, what of the word of God? Hey, come on, wake up! Wake up! You see? A very authoritative head. And you start shivering because of lack of observation of detail on the road. You want to kill people, eh? You are going at 150 where we expect you to be driving at 60. Come here. And you think you will get into heaven through avenues of mercy which are not founded on the truth. That God, I know God will have mercy on us. You know, He exercises His mercy within the climate of His grace. His grace is about His truth. Amen. You see, don't just do things and say, it's by grace. It's by grace. And they simplify things for yourself to that extent. You see, grace is interlocked with the truth. Grace is power packed in the truth. You may never have grace without the truth, because it is the grace which precipitated Christ, who is the truth. He says, I am the way, the life, and the truth. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Without me, no one can enter heaven. Are you hearing that? Without me, the truth, no one can see God. Even if you believe in a lot of grace outside the truth about Jesus, you will not enter. Grace is meant to advantage you, you know, to accelerate you to understand the truth. And the way you err, you are forgiven because of grace. And as you keep trying, and until the truth sets you totally free, and you say, I am free, praise God. I am free. I am free. They will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Listen, we have a similar situation with Moses as well. Moses was told specificities about the tabernacle. It has to be like this. It has to be like this. Gold for the things of gold. Silver for the things of silver. If you bring brass where there is silver, it's no longer God's truthful tabernacle. The Holy Spirit won't reside in it. Say, no, let's just put, you know, gold is finished. Let's just put brass. A terrible blunder. Because brass looks like gold. Actually, from here you can see it's just gold. There's no difference between Don't cheat yourself. Don't be so religious with spiritual matters to that extent. Nothing, no one looks like Jesus. Are you hearing me? No one looks like Jesus. For you to assume freedom, you ought only to be with Jesus Christ. Only. They will know the truth, and the truth will set them free. In other words, it is in your ability to distinguish truth from lies, or lies from truth, and choose the truth after the distinction, which will save you. No, churches are many. No, let's not just look down on other churches. Then I said, no, I look down on them when they don't have the truth, man. Why do you want to teach me nothing like that? You want to invite your own messes around the religions. No, don't you see? Somebody came to me and said, no, you are a powerful preacher. But I didn't like your castigation of other churches. Then I said, no, I was just castigating wrong ones. There are no wrong ones. And I say, those that don't have the truth are wrong. I wanted them to have the truth. I was helping them. I was not castigating them. Only if they invited the truth. Like this other apostolic sect, you see, they were praying in their own way and so on, and one of them came to our services and listened to me preaching. The following day, he brought his leadership. Then after church, they came to me and said, Baba, we now want the truth. We were lying to people. You see, some of these people, when they repent, those people they were leading, some of them refused to, even when their leaders were repenting to the truth. To be so used to lies that you make lies your truth. That even when the leader of lies repents to the truth, you remain in the lies. Then he said, no, I cannot. I have received Jesus. You know, if you want. They said, no, we are going to Joanna, so Shan, you know, you have betrayed us. We're betrayed when I have the truth now. I'm free. I was delivered by these men. You see? So don't be such an ardent follower who, when his leader repents and they receive the truth, you argue for lies. Because you are used to lies. You see, we want something that gives you a relationship with God, and that is the truth only. Nothing can give you the truth. It can give you a sound relationship with God apart of the truth, Jesus Christ. You see, I will read you this scripture in Exodus chapter 19, verse 5. Now therefore, if you obey my voice, are you hearing that? And indeed keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me. You shall above all people, for all the earth is mine. You shall be a peculiar people. A holy people. The Bible, it continues to say, a holy people in Exodus. Listen. However, it's the crucial truth I want you to grasp this morning, to know how to vehicle yourself in the things of God and not just an innocent believer. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice, that is the voice of the truth, indeed, and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. For all the earth is mine. In 6 it says, and you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests. Are you hearing that? Hey, God's grace. This is how God demonstrates his grace. When you obey him, when you obey his truth, he accelerates you into righteousness, into holiness. Are you with me? He accelerates you. When you obey his truth, you must be patient with yourself around the truth. And he shall be unto me a kingdom of priests, and a holy nation, and a holy nation. Are you getting that? You shall be a kingdom of the truth. You at the top, you are a peculiar people. God, in all the efforts he is making, you know, towards humanity, it is to make them a peculiar people. Even in the old times, what I always call the cosmology of time, God's intention is to come up with a peculiar people. You were created. He wants to make you original. That person who was created in the Old Testament, you see, that native creature, that native innocent creature was peculiar. God has got a blueprint. Are you with me? Of who you are. How you are behaving is not about who exactly you are. You have been influenced by the environment. You have been influenced by doctrines of men. You have been influenced by, systems of men. You have been influenced by ngangas, by false prophets, by they have insinuated your mind to the extent that you are stuck on lies as though it was the truth. You are failing to exhibit the peculiar man God created in Genesis chapter 1. You are failing to exhibit the holy man God created in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. You are failing to be that priest which God created. God wanted to be served by priest-like people right from the beginning. That is God's concept of church. I am going to prove you, I'm going to trigger you. Never resist reproof of conscience. Today, when you hear this word, do not harden your hearts. Don't harden your hearts. Who is that? Thank you, Jesus. I will take you to Peter. I want you to see the peculiarity of God and the peculiarity of his love. By merely observing the law, if they had managed to observe the law enough, they were going to be converted into a peculiar people. They were going to be converted into a holy nation. They were going to be converted into a priesthood. Every home must smolder in the priestlyhood spirit. Every family must embrace the spirithood, the priesthood spirit. But when there are other spirits that are dominating that environment, arguments will be the order of the day. When the Spirit of God is dominating the environment, peace prevails. Everyone takes after the peace of the Holy Spirit. You see? I have heard of people who have killed each other fighting for a dollar. Read papers sometimes. You will enjoy the peace that is in you. Fighting for a card of beer. Then he killed his friend. Why did you drink? Hey, this world is ruled by Satan. Why did you drink when I was away? Why did you open it? And he was killed for opening his card in the absence of its owner. Hey, don't run your families in an arid way outside influence of the Spirit of God. You've been trouble. Are you hearing me? You've been trouble. Some people are just in marriages of convenience. Otherwise, they have contenders instead of a friend they are walking around with in life. They know in the pronunciation of any small statement, there is conflict. Any small thing. That's why you get into some families, you admire them for peace. No, that is false peace. That is negative peace. They can't speak because the moment they speak, there is trouble. So they have decided to solve the problem by generating negative peace. Don't think it's positive. It will be negative. The father is quiet. The mother is quiet. But they look at each other very often. In a very suspicious way. No, that is not peace. Do you understand, elder? If they want to sing, they don't produce, you know, audible words. They are... What song is that? What they're saying? I'm just singing. Even for asking what the meaning of the harm is, you can be in trouble. Because it's a harm power packed with Satan. Of a clip. That lady is laughing. Maybe in repentance. Hey! Then the father hears from the back of the house. What did you say to the child? Yeah? What? Christians, are you hearing me? We are blessed to be in the truth. We are free. You see, I want you, as I close, to see God's persuasion, where it is leading us to. Are you hearing me? You have heard in the book, in the Old Testament, that He was assured of making those people peculiar. He was assuring them that they will be peculiar. He was assuring them that they will be a holy nation, that they will be a priesthood. And we are hearing this very language in 1 Peter 2, verse 9. But ye are a chosen generation. Hallelujah. Look at what God would like to end up with in you. First of all, you must have that understanding that you are a chosen generation. As a result, you are not expected to be in a relationship of impudence with God, of contending with God, you see, of fighting with God, of disagreements. You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. Priesthood has come, but this time with royalty. Marabashakabo. Why? Because of the royal blood of Jesus Christ. Because Christ is King. Praise God. But you are a chosen generation, a holy priesthood. I mean, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. Those three distinct descriptions about what God is aiming at. This is the character. This is the character of the first human being before the deceiver came into the Garden of Eden. Abraham was a peculiar man. Adam was a peculiar man. Adam was a priest of the priesthood. He was there to worship God as a true worshiper. This description that we get from 1 Peter 2 verse 9 is the description of a true worshiper who is spoken about in John chapter 4. True worshiper. Adam as a true worshiper is peculiar. Are you hearing me? Listen to me. This message does not sound very exciting because it lacks the charisma, but it is power-packed with the truth. You have to know what God is developing in you. You have to quite know what God is developing in you so that you live not as an impudent child, audacious child, but as a child of obedience. If you obey, today when you hear my voice, do not harden your hearts. Are you with me? Do not harden your hearts, because he wants to make you a peculiar people. He wants to make you a, you know, of the royal priesthood. He wants to make you a holy nation. That's the reason for which he chose you. You are a chosen generation. What for? For the purpose of priesthood, which we lost in the Garden of Eden. For the reason of, you know, holy nation, which we lost in the garden. For the reason of being made a peculiar people, which we lost in the Garden of Eden. And when we lost that status, we lost the blessing that accompanies it. All the blessings that you see arrayed in the book of Genesis that were ascribed for the first man cannot relate well with us, in the sense that we have lost peculiarity, we have lost holiness, we have lost, you know, priesthood. We are no longer the true worshiper whom we see in the Garden of Eden. My dear child, the reason why you are coming to church, it is because you are chosen of God in this generation. Amen. Amen. You are chosen of God. Don't take that as a light thing, to be chosen of God. It's a serious matter. Why chosen by God? To retain you originality. To retain you originality. So that you don't go around knocking on people all the time. Do you know that there are people who are more prepared to fight than to reason? They say, I'm not prepared to say things and I want to fight. You know? What a model of the devil. You see, stop talking. It's no longer time to talk. a true model of the devil. You see, the devil is a destroyer. When you want to fight, you have manifested your father. You want to destroy. Do you know that fighting is a manifestation of destruction? It implies you can never fight unless you are demon possessed. Why did you beat this person?
You see, they did this, they did that. You know, I was provoked to justify anger. No, you were provoked to manifestation of the devil.
Even when you are provoked, when you are a child of God, you don't beat anyone. Because that's why Jesus said, the prince of the world cometh, but there's nothing of his in me. Are you hearing that language? You ought not to have anything of the devil in you. Don't justify your anger by beating people, by destroying, by stealing, by killing. No, 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 no. That's why I'm against the violence. Because you cannot arrive at peace using the devil and maintain the peace, because the devil will claim other things from that peace, because he is the one who would have helped you attain it. I wish you could hear this language very well. I'm against the violence, you know, especially, you know, a violent conflict, because it produces you the results of the devil, which he will further manipulate, because it is his result. You arrived at that kind of false peace using the devil. It is like a person who is going to Nganga, and then there is a false peace at home, but bigger demons will manifest in that home in the future. Are you with me? That's why I hate violence. Any form of violence I hate, because you can never be violent without manifesting a demon. And when you achieve something through the help of a demon, it is the demon's province. Bigger demons come to settle for bigger crimes. He is justified because he is the one who helped you attain that victory. So understand me, don't label me when I call for peace. I'll be meaning it. I hate violence. So whenever you become violent in the family, you can never be violent without a demon. Are you with me? It's better for you to cry and be labeled as weak, even though you are a man, than to be violent. Oh, you're manifesting a demon. That's why, you see, the demon, otherwise, one of these days, you give your wife just a light clap and the demon kills her because you are in the environment of the devil. See, I never beat her so hard. But you were used to beating until the devil has trapped you with the day he wants to kill that person. Yes, the clap was not so big and so thunderous, but the devil was behind the clap, was the devil who was so big and so thunderous. You see, let's raise our hands. Father, you are great. You are great and mighty. Always you are great. We love the great God. We love the mighty God. We worship the great and the mighty God. I bless you, Lord. I bless you, Father. You are excellent in everything you do. We love you, God Almighty. Thank you for today. It's a wonderful day. Thank you for today. You have spoken to us that we be a peculiar people, that we be a holy nation, that we be a wonderful people for God. We bless you. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Father. In Jesus' excellent and mighty name, we pray. Amen.